Good morning, Earthlings. How you doing? Welcome to the show. First Contact Radio is the place. FirstContactRadio.com. All right, so let's start things off today with our space weather. Take a look at where we're at, what we're dealing with. Starting off, we have our solar wind. All right, we have our solar wind here. It's at 444 kilometers per second, so it's staying about where it was yesterday. Our planetary K index is at 1. It's going to move up to 2. And down here, low chance of an M-class flare, so nothing really to be concerned about there. We have some meteor showers that are going to be taking place over the course of the next couple days. The Leonids meteor showers. It says Earth is passing through the debris field of comet Tempel-Tuttle, parent of the annual Leonid meteor shower, bearing a direct hit by a filament of dust, which forecasters consider unlikely. This year's shower should be mild. Peak rates of 10 to 20 meteors per hour are expected around the 17th and the 18th. So if you're watching the sky tonight, you might get a nice little show. Okay, I want to bring your attention to something over here, because I bring this up quite a bit, and I thought maybe we would give a bit of more of an explanation. This planetary K index. So right underneath here, we're just going to go to this explanation page, and it says, relationship between the KP and the aurora. Now, in this article, we will briefly explain some of the ideas behind the association of the aurora with the geomagnetic activity and a bit about how the K index or K factor works. The aurora is understood to be caused by the interaction of high energy particles, usually electrons, with neutral atoms in the Earth's upper atmosphere. These high energy particles can excite, by collision, valence electrons that are bound to neutral atoms. The excited electron can then de-excite and return back to its initial low energy state. But in the process, it releases a photon, a light particle. The combined effect of many photons being released from many atoms results in the aurora display that you are seeing. The details of how high energy particles are generated during a geomagnetic storm constitute an entire discipline of space science in its own right. The basic idea, however, is that the Earth's magnetic field, let us say the geomagnetic field, is responding to an outwardly propagating disturbance from the Sun. As the geomagnetic field adjusts to the disturbance, various components of the Earth's field change form, releasing magnetic energy and thereby accelerating charged particles to high energies. These particles, being charged, are forced to stream about or along the geomagnetic field lines. Some end up in the upper part of the Earth's neutral atmosphere, and the auroral mechanism begins. The disturbance of the geomagnetic field may also be measured by an instrument called a magnetometer. At the operation center, we receive magnetometer data from dozens of observations in 1-minute intervals. The data is received at or near real time and allows us to keep track of the current state of the geomagnetic conditions. In order to reduce the amount of data that our customers have to deal with, we convert the magnetometer data into 3 hourly indices, which give a quantitative but less detailed measure of the geomagnetic activity. The K-index scale has a range from 0 to 9 and is directly related to the maximum amount of fluctuation relative to a quiet day in the geomagnetic field over a 3-hour interval. The K-index, therefore, is updated every 3 hours, and the information is made available to our customers as soon as possible. For K indexes are also necessarily tied to a specific geomagnetic observatory. For locations where there are no observations or observatories, one can only estimate what the local K index would be by looking at the data from the nearest observatory. This would be subject to some errors from time to time because geomagnetic activity is not always spatially homogeneous. Another item of interest is that the location of the aurora usually changes geomagnetic latitude as the intensity of the geomagnetic storm changes. The location of the aurora usually takes on an oval-like shape and is approximately called the auroral oval. A useful map of the approximate location of the auroral oval as a function of the KP index was published in the June 1968 copy Sky and Telescope. The KP index is derived through by an algorithm that essentially averages the K indices from several stations. Note that as the storm becomes more intense, the edge of the auroral boundary typically moves lower latitudes. All right. So basically, what we've got going on here during the course of this time, as it says, is you've got the activity coming outside the solar system. It's hitting the ionosphere. The Earth is being excited. The energies down here are being released upward, and the two are clashing together. And in this clashing of these energies, we have the aurora field, which is being created, all the bright, colorful lights in the sky that people are seeing. And then this index here is rated at a variety of different observatories around the world. And as they are rated and people take that information, it's all averaged together and these ratings come out with. So we could see that the average rating of 1 tells us that there isn't a lot of activity taking place between the electromagnetic energy from the solar system and that which is on the planet, which is being excited by the energy. So those two work together, and that's how we come up with these numbers. And so it's important that you understand what these numbers are, and as I'm reading this on a daily basis, so you could see what type of energies are down here on the planet. Obviously, if this is really high, it's, you know, we're going to feel something a bit different, because we all know what it's like to feel static electricity. We can all feel that all the time from things. So, you know, if we look at these, we might be able to make some comparisons in how things feel around us on a daily basis. So there you have it. Thought that would be a good little explanation for you about what's going on there. Dirk's not with us for today, so we're going to jump right over to the UFO news. Here we go.
This is the UFO news with Joshua Poet.
All right, here we go. UFO news. First thing up is a story from the Examiner. Turkey UFO spotted over Yalova with an uncommon shape and appearance. On Saturday, November 12th, the UFO was seen over Yalova, Turkey. This UFO had an appearance that was very dissimilar from most, if not any, other UFO previously caught on camera. The Turkey UFO report posted the most amazing known photos of this recent UFO sighting. The pictures show an unidentified flying craft that was square and boxy in shape. It appeared to have three-dimensional sides that formed the shape of an upside-down letter U or horseshoe. Turkey UFO report is the website of the UFO observer named Orthan, who hails from Yalova, the site of this recent UFO sighting. He has shared 9 photographs of this unusual identified flying object on YouTube. The UFO seems to be hovering in place in the sky between the above 2 homes of the buildings. All right, let's take a look at these photos here. It goes on to say the first 4 photos show the UFO from one angle at various magnifications. The following 5 pictures seem to show the same object from the same vantage point. All right, let's find out what these look like here. Okay. So our first one, All right. Oh, look at all those. Okay, here we go. All right, we just got this distance one here, so we really can't get a big idea of what this is. However, we are familiar with the rounded shape, and this one does look a little different. Okay, there we go. A little better, and as we move closer. So that's pretty much it. So let's back up here. So we can see here that this shape is not the typical shape we see. We're usually seeing those rounded shapes, right? The orbs, or more of the oval shape if it's one of the crafts, or the V shapes. But here, this is absolutely different. This is the square shape. It's not really a complete square unless there's something going on down here that we're not seeing aside. All right, very interesting looking one. And the next one here comes to us from over Texas. So let's take a look at this. All right, you can see we got the object right here. You see it moving across. And you can see as it's moving across how it's changing directions. Now it's going back. See right here? It's making some interesting maneuvers. It went all the way across, did a circle, come down. Okay. All right, that was over the skies of Hearst, Texas on November 15th. Here we have a story. This comes to us from latestufosightings.net. This was over Wisconsin on the 15th. UFO video activity was recorded over Ripon in Wisconsin on Tuesday. This witness report in response to another case reported from Winnebago area, Winnebago area, case number 33373. UFOs were visible from Ripon, Wisconsin as well. Also appeared to be in the western direction and not too far in the distance. I've been star bathing for about 6 years now and with much video proof for many activities in my area, as well as the objects on the ground. And in my tree, 60 feet off the porch, which I may send video for to another time. These particular objects I have gotten on the video basically doing the same thing in 2009 for 3 days with our lovely military closing their best to chase them for 7 or 8 fighter jets. All right, let's see here. Let's just take a look at the object. Oh. Yeah, look at that one up there. That's quite fascinating. Oh, it just faded out now. You could see that when they first show it, right in this area here, looks kind of, this is the one that does look more of the oval shape. The lights are going across. And, all right, very fascinating. Over Wisconsin, and right here we have a story from UFO Digest. Common thread connecting the Rendlesham Forest UFO event in two crop formations. The 1980 Rendlesham Forest UFO event, the 2002 Crabwood crop formation, and the 2010 Witten Windmill crop formation are logically connected. Each event yielded a set of binary data, which was decoded using a common image decoding algorithm. The algorithm was discovered in part of the Wilton Windmill data set. It was then applied to all the data in the Wilton Windmill formation. Remarkably, 4 meaningful images were decoded by ordering the data bits in different ways. One image shows a bipedal figure with one arm raised. Another shows the same figure in a different pose with the other arm raised. A third image shows a man with large ears and a drawing of a bunny in a child's book. And a fourth image shows what appears to be a child riding a tricycle. The data set from the Crabwood formation was decoded as a bipedal figure extending a 3-fingered hand in greeting. Finally, the data set that came from the UFO encounter in Rendlesham Forest was decoded as the profile of a seated cat or dog. The images from 1980 to 2002 events could not have been found until the decoding algorithm appeared in 2010. Further, there must have been a plan prior to the 1980 event to enable these images to be revealed in 2010. The images appeared to say that the authors are not to be feared and therefore are probably not human. On May 22, 2010, a crop formation appeared at Winton Windmill, Wiltshire, England. The formation was found to represent bits of information that encoded a famous mathematical formula. The article shows that the additional testing string as well as 4 recognizable images were encoded in the formation. The second test string was interpreted as a high-level algorithm for decoding the images. Unexpectedly, the same algorithm decoded a meaningful image from the 2009 Crabwood crop formation. Even more surprisingly, an image was also decoded from a bit sequence that originated in the UFO encounter at Rendlesham, 1980. All right, and they go on in this article here to discuss each of these in separate sections. This was the formation at Wilton Windmill. And then, as you can see, it's been broken down to show you what all of this means here. And they even went ahead and show the figures a little close up when they break them down and use the binary to decipher these images. And then this is said to be the Crabwood Formation. And the same information from that other crop circle, the Wilton Windmill, it was used and applied to understand what this was about. And again, they came up with some images here, a bit blurry as you can see. And then finally, they get into discussing the Rendlesham incidents and how they all connect. You can see there's quite a bit here to the article. The conclusion here is, says, six meaningful images were decoded from three sets of data using the same decoding algorithm. Because the decoding algorithm was specified in the latest data set, all the data sets must have been designed by the same agency. Further, we were not meant to see the images until 2010 when the decoding algorithm was provided. Three of the images offer greetings, and the remaining three depict harmless animals and a child. The implied messages seem to be that we should not fear the authority of these images when we eventually meet, since the messages would be trivial if the source were a human agency. We may infer that the authors are probably not human. So, very interesting indeed. Tomorrow on the show, I'm going to have a guest, and that is Peter Robbins, who wrote the book Left of Eastgate, and he's going to talk about such things. We did have, when we talked about this kind of issue, so it'll come up tomorrow in the interview. You'll be able to hear more about that. So, very interesting. These articles and information will be up. They're not up right now, but after the show, I'll get them all posted at firstcontactradio.com, right-hand side, UFO News. And there you have it. That's our news for today. I'm going to jump away. When I come back, we've got some more news and information. So, wake up.
What if our government was responsible for some of the greatest crimes against this nation? Would you really want to know? These are big questions. But these questions deserve answers. It's time to demand the truth.
Wake up. Patriots, arise. It's time to demand the truth.
All right, very good. I'm back. Again, the song's called Wake Up. You can download it free, firstcontactradio.com. Spread it around. Share it with your friends. We all need to wake up. All right, Ron Paul. Ron Paul is next up in the news here. Got the, it's titled here, Can Ron Paul Win in Iowa? Of course, you know about the big elections coming up and how they're all scrambling to get their candidate, and you've seen many of the debates, and well, Ron Paul keeps making headway despite the fact that the mainstream media is trying to ignore him. He's hard to ignore when he has so many people out supporting, so check this out.
Showing a four-way tie for first place in Iowa between Herman Cain, Newt Gingrich, Mitt Romney, and Ron Paul, all within the statistical margin of error. It is raising questions about whether Congressman Paul could see a new campaign surge in the coming weeks. And we are joined now by the Texas congressman and a 2012 presidential candidate, Ron Paul. Congressman, thank you so much for being here. So that's got to come as good news to you. Many people have considered you sort of an also-ran in this race, not your supporters, and certainly not from the look of that poll, the good people of Iowa.
Well, we're very pleased. Of course, not totally surprised because our internal polls have been pretty favorable. But also, I have been talking about significant change in the economy and the foreign policy. And the good reception I'm getting on the campaign trail, especially with young people, I'm very pleased with the recognition that we actually are polling so well.
Where is the recognition by in particular, the mainstream media? We saw a debate the other night on foreign policy, on which, you know, that's a matter on which you've been very vocal. And yet, despite polls showing you creeping up in the polls, and with the American voters, you get 89 seconds in that debate. 89.
I wished I knew the absolute answer to that, because I'm always asked that, but we'd have to ask the people who are managing the debates on why there was this exclusion. And I can postulate. Sometimes they don't want to hear what I have to say, because I do challenge the status quo of both parties and our foreign policy and the policy of the Federal Reserve, which serves a lot of powerful special interests. So there's a concerted effort to make sure these views aren't circulated too widely.
I want to ask you about, you've sort of been a watchdog financially on Capitol Hill for a long time, complaining about overspending and revenue issues from the Fed on down. Right now, one of the lead stories today is this super committee and projections that it is headed perhaps for what the co-chair described as possible abject failure. You believe even if they achieve big success, it's going to be, quote, puny, the cuts that they make. And, you know, it's like teaspoons in the ocean. Tell us.
Yeah, from my viewpoint, they're not really talking about cuts. You know, my proposal is to cut $1 trillion of real cuts in the first year. But they're talking about cutting $1 trillion over 10 years, and they're only talking about cutting proposed increases from the baseline. So those aren't real cuts. But I think there's two things. One is they don't want to admit the country's bankrupt and there's not a strong necessity for us to do something. And the other thing is that they won't consider changing policy. So you can't tinker around the edges and get rid of waste and fraud in a program here or there. What you have to do is decide what the role of government ought to be. Should the government be the policeman of the world, and should our government be passing out welfare from cradle to grave? And I don't think we can afford it, and I don't think that's what it was designed for. But the country, basically a lot of people still, as well as the politicians here, they're in denial. They don't realize we're technically bankrupt. We're insolvent. We can't pay the bills. The only thing that keeps us going is this illusion that our dollars will last forever, and all we have to do is create new money, pay the bills, and bail out Europe and everybody else. But that's coming to an end, and that's what our financial crisis is telling us.
You know who's not bankrupt is former House Speaker and now Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi. She and her husband worth tens of millions of dollars. And there was a 60 Minutes report this week, and it's catching fire in the mainstream media as well, on how members of Congress, including not just Nancy Pelosi, but they profiled John Boehner as well, the Republican leader, they're not subjected to the same insider trading regulations that the rest of the world is. And it's resulted, they pointed out, in Boehner investing in health insurance company shares before it was announced that the public option had been axed. And he made a bunch of money. And Pelosi and her husband doing the same thing with a Visa initial public offering when she had some some inside information about how Visa was about to come out smelling like a rose. Should members of Congress be allowed to do this, sir?
Well, they shouldn't do it, obviously, because it's unethical. But I'm not positive that the members of Congress aren't under the laws. You know, if you commit fraud and inside trading, I can't see where in the law it's written, except for congressmen. Maybe the enforcement is there's an exception in there, but it's wrong. And the real correction for this is having only ethical people in government rather than those that go with the whims of the lobbyists. But when you enrich yourself by a position in government, that's pretty bad. And obviously the people have a right to know about it, and they have a right to react to it. And if they're breaking the law, they should be punished.
Ron Paul, always a pleasure speaking with you, sir. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Megan.
Okay, so making good headway right there. You could see they're trying to keep him down, but you can't keep a good man down. Not when he keeps doing good things and people keep stepping up, because he makes sense. You know, he wants a mess. He wants peace. He talks about peace. He talks about ending the Fed, which has been screwing us over. Have you had a chance to watch that movie Thrive? If not, you know, go watch that movie. It's the link is at our page. It's on the Daily News for yesterday. You also got the direct link right on the page if you want to go get the DVD or anything like that. It's really, really a worthwhile movie. It explains a lot of things. It's, you know, it starts off going one way, where you think the movie's going to kind of go one direction. All of a sudden, it kind of changes on you, and it does it in a really good, subtle way, and it really informs you about what's going on. So it's a really, really good movie for this time that we're in. All right, now next, we all know about the Wall Street movements. We all hear about Zuccotti Park and how it's being raided. We've heard the stories for weeks that the media is spouting out that there's only hippies out there. But then that changed because then military personnel started showing up. And then you started seeing, you know, elderly folks out there and middle-aged folks and working folks. And you started seeing a lot more than what the media was talking about. Yet still in the midst of all of this remained the police brutality. And I'd have to imagine at this period of time, 2 weeks, 2 months into this, the police are probably getting pretty tired because this has been a daily battle that they've had to fight against the people. Now, why are they fighting against the people? That's a good question. And maybe after 2 months' period of time, maybe that's a question that they're asking themselves. Why are they still fighting against the people? Because obviously the people aren't going to get worn down because there's millions of more people than there are police. Maybe the police are going to have a change of heart. Think about what they're doing. We could only hope, right? Since they're the ones walking around carrying the guns, wearing the body armor, we can only hope that they will have some sort of integrity, because if they don't, we could really be in a big problem. Now, here's a story, which is a good story, because it's a Philadelphia police chief, police captain, Jones, and he's talking about Occupy Wall Street. He says here, retired Philadelphia police captain Ray Lewis has joined Occupy Wall Street, calling the New York Police Department's conduct disgusting and totally uncalled for. Let's listen to what Captain Lewis has to say.
Analyst, and well, from my knowledge of Oath Keepers, they are. We respectfully differ on Oath Keepers.
The live stream is asking, why are you here?
Excuse me, hold on 1 minute. Go ahead.
We see your sign? We see your sign?
Oh, yeah, sure. I have two signs.
NYPD.
So how do you, what's the best way for,
NYPD, watch inside jive, and then join us, sorry.
So how do you, so it's like a conundrum, right? I mean, like, everyone says that, you know, the cops are just following orders, don't blame them. But then people also say that
NYPD, watch inside job, then join us. That sounds simple.
But then people also say that, you know, that you can't. They are making their own decisions. Where do you see that? Where do you draw the line? What's the? How is it? How do you reach out? What will change that about cops? Do they do? Do you suggest they defy orders, or do we go above them? Or
I'm not, yeah, you have to go to. How do you solve the problem? You have to get rid of corporate America. You have to get rid of the power that they have. You have to greatly
control every transaction and what's going on there. And basically, you have to make them impotent. Because as long as they have the power, they're going to continue to exploit and manipulate the working class. All the cops are, they're just workers for the 1%, and they don't even realize they're being exploited.
What kind of relationship do you have with the cops? Do they see you as being one of them? Or
they're trying to get me arrested.
They're trying to get you
and
arrested.
And I may disappear, okay? But as soon as I'm not going to go to prison, but as soon as I'm let out of jail, I'll be right back here. And they'll have to arrest me again.
Happened to all of us, at least a lot of us, at least once or twice already, so you won't be alone. Do you see any, do you get like any sense of this camaraderie with any of them
are
aligned with you? Or
I'm
all
their worst enemy.
Really?
Especially with the white shirts, the bosses. Okay, some of the fellow cops, they might be thinking, you know, that guy, you got a point. But the bosses, I'm their number one enemy. And they always take out the leader of a group. That's why if you ever have a cop in here asking, I mean, undercover, you know, he's in plain clothes and all, and he's asking, who's the leader of this group? Who's the leader? That's a cop. Okay? Because they always want to take out the leaders.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Fuck yeah. Our leaders.
All right, I'm really a real cop.
Of course.
Do you have any suggestions for civilians such as myself? You know, like take precautions towards.
Don't confront them because you're going to lose.
Absolutely.
Physically. Okay. They tell you to move, obey every order they give you, and if you think they're illegal orders, get in touch with the ACLU and get them involved. And the fact that I'm told that they confiscated all the tents and the sleeping bags and whatnot, and they trashed them. I don't know if that's true, but if that is true, to me, that's theft, and they should be arrested. But it may not be, I don't know how true that is. But I know they confiscated it. Whether they trashed it or not, I don't know. It might be in a place where people can go and get it.
Yes.
So what's going on with regards to the NYPD? What exactly is going on here? Who do they take orders from? Why have they been beating people? Is it legal? And how does it work in the structure as like the chain of command? Is it going from the commander-in-chief
It's going from the mayor.
And who's telling the mayor?
He's independent here. This is his city, okay? And the police commissioner works for the mayor. And the mayor is telling the police commissioner how he wants this handled. And then the police commissioner sends it down to all the other top-ranking white shirts.
Now, occupations all over the country are being evicted over the past 3 days and continuing. It seems like a collective effort. Is that crazy, or is there cooperation between all states to try to squash the Occupy movement?
Well, there's cooperation between all corporate America.
But that doesn't mean that it's the feds. It just means that it's...
Doesn't mean it's the feds?
Yeah, because people say, it's the FBI, it's the CIA, if it's everybody...
Oh, they'll be in on it. Everybody will be in on it if this continues to grow. Right now, they think the official city police or township police can handle these occupations. But if it continues to grow, you're going to see a lot more of the... FBI and everything else.
Okay. Do you have any, more words of wisdom to how to basically better understand? I think there's a real lack of understanding on myself, definitely, of exactly, the mentality of a police officer. They, off-duty, would never take a baseball bat and beat anybody up, but on-duty feels completely justified. Is it just being told that that's his job, or is it, what is it?
Okay. It's a job. First of all, you should, by law, only use force to protect someone's life or to protect them from being bodily injured. Okay? If you're not protecting somebody's life or protecting them from bodily injury, there's no need to use force. And the number one thing that they always have in their favor that they seldom use is negotiation. Continue to talk and talk and talk to people. You have nothing to lose by that. But this bull rush, what happened last night, is totally uncalled for when they did not use negotiation long enough. Negotiation, there's never a downside to negotiation. And they complained about the park being dirty. Here they are worrying about dirty parks when people are starving to death, where people are freezing, where people are sleeping in subways, and they're concerned about a dirty park. That's obnoxious, it's arrogant, it's ignorant, it's disgusting. That they would spend so much time getting you people out here so they can clean the park. It's a farce.
And then when they clean it, they didn't bring us back any of the garbage bins to throw anything away.
Yeah, see? Analyst and, from my knowledge of Oath Keepers, they are. We respectfully differ on Oath Keepers.
The live stream is asking...
All right, so little by little, you can see that the movement is adjusting and changing because there are those who are in authority positions, like police officers and military personnel, who are seeing what's going on. You know, the police are really the ones who are caught in the middle. They're being used. They think that they're part of the 1% just because that they are doing their bidding for them. They're going to find out that they're not, and when they do find out, they're going to really be angry. When will that moment come? I'm not quite certain, but you could see some of them are. Here you've got one officer. That will lead to a second officer and a third officer. They need to really wake up because they're going to be the ones caught in the middle. And what happens when they find themselves on the outside looking in? Who are they going to stand with? The people that they were beating on and expect that the people are going to accept them in open arms? Probably not. So they're in a bind and they need to figure it out. They need to get a little bit more integrity, remember, to serve and protect. Not too long ago, that used to be something that was valued in this country if you were a peace officer. But these days, it seems to have been out the window. Now, we're going to go back to the issue of 9/11 here for a couple of stories. This is Bob Bowman. Bob Bowman talks about Building 7, World Trade Center, that went down on 9/11. Here we go.
I'm Dr. Bob Bowman, Lieutenant Colonel, United States Air Force, retired. Flew 101 combat missions in Vietnam and directed all the DOD Star Wars programs under Presidents Ford and Carter. My PhD is in aeronautics and nuclear engineering from Caltech. I did my postdoctoral work at the von Karman Institute in Brussels, Belgium, in finite element analysis. I taught at 5 colleges and universities, serving as department head and assistant dean. Finite element analysis is the solution of complex physical problems using advanced mathematics, things like turbulent flow or structural failure. I first became aware that there was a problem with the government's official conspiracy theory on 9/11. That very morning, when I was watching what was happening on television, and my wife says, I kept saying over and over, where are the interceptors? And then, of course, when the first of the towers actually started falling down, I just said, this can't happen. It can't happen. And then the other tower came down, and I said, this violates the laws of physics. It can't happen. Those aircraft and those fires could not cause those buildings to come down in that way. So I guess I was a very early skeptic. And then, of course, the coup de grace for me was when I found out that Building 7 had collapsed later that day. And when I saw Building 7 come down, to me, Building 7, the fact that its collapse was announced prematurely by the BBC and CNN, and just seeing it come down in what, for all the world, looks like a perfect controlled demolition of an intact building, I mean, that's what I call a smoking gun. And you put all these things together, and it is absolutely obvious to me that we've been lied to, that the government's official story is physically impossible, and that's why we absolutely need a new investigation of 9/11. You know, I signed that petition for architects and engineers for 9/11 truth some time ago, because as an engineer, I have 3 degrees in engineering, I know that the government story is an absolute lie. Totally convinced of it. There's a lot of people trying to convince me that the government story is the truth, and they don't come close. I fully agree with what you guys are saying, and the evidence that you have come up with over the last several years about the thermite and the speed of collapse and all the details should clinch it for just about anybody, certainly does for me. The architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth have collected evidence from a number of sources that prove conclusively, as far as I'm concerned, that there was controlled demolition on that morning with those three buildings. Now, everybody is probably pretty familiar with that evidence, the free fall speed of the buildings, and in particular the thermite in the dust from all three of the buildings. There's no question but that those things could not happen because of aircraft hitting a building and fires. We know we've been lied to about 9/11. We don't know for sure who did it. We don't know exactly how they did everything. And that's why we need a new investigation to find out. But in the meantime, there are things we do know. We do know that there was a massive cover-up, that there was evidence hidden and destroyed. The American people absolutely need the truth of 9/11.
Okay, so again, another person saying that we don't have the truth, another high-ranking official, person in the military. So very important that we get to the bottom of it. Now, he mentioned World Trade Center 7. We talked about World Trade Center 7 numerous times. It is the smoking gun because it did go down as the third building on the day of 9/11. Most people don't know about it. So I found this video here. It's a guy named Bob Tuskin. It says, rather than stand outside some park in downtown area of our city, why don't we occupy Building 7, the third building that was not hit by a plane on 9/11 but happened to fall at near free fall speed? So here he is doing interviews with different people in Florida on what they know about Building 7. This is quite interesting to see what people actually do know and what they don't know. Check this out. I think you're going to be quite surprised. All right, there's the building. In case you haven't seen it, as you can see, that looks like a building that went down by fire.
I wondered if you guys had heard of Building 7 before?
No.
So are you familiar with Building 7?
I am not.
No, I'm not.
All right, have you seen the footage of the collapse of Building 7?
No.
It's the third building that fell on September 11, 2001. There's a lot of questions about it. Do you think...
I've heard about it, but I need to go, man.
All right, thank you.
But I've heard about the issue, yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. He's heard about it. He had to go. All right, we'll continue to ask people before they cross the stream. Okay, I'll give you a hint. It was the third building in New York that was 47 stories tall that ever collapsed from structural fire.
You've got me there. I have no idea.
Have you guys seen the footage of Building 7?
No.
All right, it was a 47-story building in New York. Larry Silverstein was the owner.
No.
Does it ring a bell?
No.
Okay, it was the third building that fell on September 11, 2001.
No, never seen it.
No. Neither have I.
Did they teach it to you maybe in school or something?
No.
What did they tell you about 9/11? Just the story about the hijackers?
No.
They don't teach you anything about 9/11 in school?
No.
No, okay. No, it was... a 47-story high-rise building. Larry Silverstein owned the property at the time.
I think I took a class about it, but I don't remember.
Okay. All right. Do you think that they should teach kids about what happened on that dreadful day?
Yeah, all Americans should know about that.
It's an important thing. And do you think if we still have questions that about what happened, we should have them answer?
Yes, of course.
I'm not sure of the facts that you're, so I, without researching it, I wouldn't have an opinion.
All right, so you just got to watch the footage is what we're asking.
Yeah, I'll check the footage.
Yeah, you can find it on YouTube anywhere. We just want people to use critical thinking. I study philosophy and logic and that kind of thing, so.
Yeah, I will use critical thinking. I'll watch the footage and see what the reports are.
Does the name Larry Silverstein ring a bell by chance?
No.
Okay, he was the owner of the Trade Center in New York on the day of 9/11. He owned the insurance policy. And he was also on film referring to Building 7. And he said, quote, there was such horrible loss of life that we decided the smartest thing to do would be pull it. And then at 5:30 in the afternoon, this 47-story building that was not hit by an airplane decides to collapse almost instantaneously in nearly free fall speed.
Yeah, I remember that. That was bad for what happened there, but yeah, it's just, what can I say? Except it's we just had to go from what we happened and keep our guards up.
It was the third building, high-rise building, that is, that fell on September 11th, 2001. If you watch the footage, it's standing there, and then it nearly collapses in free fall speed many hours after the other buildings had fallen. Do you think whether or not there's a conspiracy, or it was that aside, that we should figure out what happened to the collapse of this building?
Definitely, yes. Yeah, I mean, what's the evidence for this? Like,
well, I mean, if you just watch the footage of this building, it's standing there, and then the building collapses into its own footprint.
I've heard some, like, conspiracies, theories about it, but I really don't know. Like, what they say makes sense, but like, I don't really know the facts of what could make a building fall or not. I will not be able to tell.
Well, there's a group called Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth.
Architecture is my major.
You're an architecture major. Okay, so you're gonna like this group, Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, ae911truth.org. There's over 1,500 of them that are demanding for a new investigation. You should look into that.
I might. What's give me some information. I'll look that up.
Yeah, ae911truth, Architects and Engineers, ae911truth.org. I'll write it down for you, and you can check it out on my website, bobtuskin.com. Where are you from?
Argentina.
Argentina. Okay. Thank you so much. Do you think we should have justice for this? I mean, it's 10 years later. I hate to still be asking this. Many might say, well, do something else, you know, get over it. But it's one of many things.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't even know about the building, so, I mean, that's interesting.
Yeah, they did cover it in the media. Actually, the BBC on the day of 9/11 reported that it had collapsed. Small little problem. It was still standing there in the live footage in the background and then collapsed 30 minutes later instantaneously. It was a 47-story high-rise building in the World Trade Center complex.
Like, what was the building used for? Like,
oh, that's a good question. What was the building used for? Well, there was a lot of different agencies in that building, including the CIA. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Giuliani had his emergency base. FEMA was in there. There was a bomb shelter. There's a lot of different things that perhaps we might want to conceal or get rid of in case of an attack. Anyways, guys, look into it and let me know what you think. Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
My friend is a huge conspiracy theorist. He's going to love, like, hearing about this.
Yeah, cool. Tell him to check out bobtuskin.com. Thank you. All right, there you go. People have friends that are conspiracy theorists.
think, like I said, all Americans should know everything that happened that day. It should be, it should go down in history books just like everything else.
I couldn't agree more. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. That's right. We need everything that happened on that dreadful day in the history books, not just his story. Real history, or else it's bound to be repeated.
All right, very good. So we definitely need to address this issue, and I don't know, do you know about that building? Have you heard of World Trade Center 7? If not, look it up. And you saw several images of it going down. Now, did that building look like a building that has gone down by fire? Because I know you all know what those kind of buildings look like, and if not, you can look that up. See, fire behaves a certain way. Fire doesn't just start off and everything goes in the same place at the same time. Fire moves randomly. It kind of moves in what's considered an organic manner. It just kind of goes where the wind's going to blow it. It burns. When it's done, it moves to the next area. Fire isn't a thing that is all of a sudden going to go into the building, immediately go to the four corners of the building, burn out the four corners so the building can fall straight down. Because what you saw in the video would have to happen. In order for a building to fall straight down like so, something on the bottom needs to be taken out down at this level here so the building can collapse. That's the only way it can happen. If only one of these corners is taken out, the building's going to tip over. If two of the corners are going to be taken out, the building tips another way. If three corners are taken out, the building tips another way. The only way for it to go straight down is the bottom has to be taken out. And that is explosives. And the descriptions that people had when they saw the building described an explosive event. From the police that were telling people to get away, that building's going to blow up, which is a clue, to the actual building going down and people describing the ripple that they were seeing going around the building. So very important that we know about that. Now, the very last thing I want to play for today before we do our meditation is I want to play one more piece on Krishnamurti. The last 2 days, I had played the pieces about the origin of fear and to understand what it is that we deal with, the issue of fear. And now this is another one. It deals with the question of who am I? Somebody asked him, and he came up with a really great answer, so I thought that I'd want to share this with you. So let's check this out. I think you're going to like this. It's got very good, insightful information.
Number 5 question is, who are you? Is that an important question? Or would you say, who am I? Not who you are, who am I? And if I tell you who I am, what does it matter? It's just be out of curiosity, isn't it? It's like reading a menu at the window. You have to go into the restaurant and eat food. But merely standing outside and reading the menu won't satisfy your hunger. So, to tell you who I am, is really quite meaningless. First of all, I'm nobody. Right? That's all. It's very simple as that. I'm nobody. But what is important is who you are. What are you? When they ask who you are, in that question is implied, you are somebody very great, therefore I'm going to imitate you. The way you walk, the way you talk, the way you brush your teeth or whatever it is. I'm going to imitate you. Which is part of our pattern, you understand? There is the hero, or the man who is enlightened, or the guru, say, I'm going to copy everything you do. has become so absurdly silly, you understand? Childish to imitate somebody. And are we not the result of a lot of imitations? Which religions have said, they don't use the word imitate, but give yourself over, surrender yourself, follow me, I am this, I am that, worship, right? All this is what you are. In school you imitate. Please, acquiring knowledge is a form of imitation. And of course there is the fashion, short dress, long hair, beard, no beard. Imitate, imitate, imitate. And also we imitate inwardly. So we all know that. But to find out who you are, not who the speaker is far more important. And to find out who you are, you have to inquire. You are the story of mankind, which is really a very, if you really see that, it gives you tremendous vitality, energy, beauty, love. Because it is no longer a small entity struggling in the corner of the earth. You're part of this whole humanity. It has a tremendous responsibility, vitality, beauty, love. But most of us won't see this. But whereas we are most of us concerned with ourselves, with our particular little problem, particular little sorrow, and so on. And to step out of that narrow circle seems almost impossible. Because we are so conditioned, so programmed like the computers, that we cannot learn something new. The computer can, but we can't. See the tragedy of it. The machine that we have created, the computer, can learn much faster, much infinitely more than I can, than the brain can. And the brain, which has invented that, that has become ultra intelligent machine. Right? Whereas our brain is sluggish, slow, dull, because we have conformed, we have obeyed, we have followed. There is the guru, there is the priest, there is the ritual. You follow? And when you do revolt, as the revolutionaries and the terrorists do, it is still very superficial. Changing the pattern of politics, of so-called society. Society is merely the relationship between people. And we are talking of a revolution, not physical. But the psychological revolution in which there is no at the depth conformity. You may put on trousers because you're in this country, and you put on in India's different clothes. That's not conformity. That's nothing childish. But inwardly, not a feeling of conformity. Conformity exists when there is comparison. But am I to be totally free from comparison? That is, to learn to observe the whole history which is embedded in you.
All right, that was really good information and wisdom from Krishnamurti. Something to contemplate. So as we do our meditation today, that'll be a good point for us to consider, who am I? Who am I? Because that's really the heart of it. So let's go ahead and close your eyes and relax. You know, one of the oldest sayings that we have is a very simple saying, know thyself. To know thyself is to understand the very question, who am I? When Moses asked God who he was, God responded, I am that I am. Therefore, in that understanding of who I am, who am I, we come to the statement of I am. And it all goes back to God, to the divinity inside each one of us. And that divinity cannot help to exist because we are made in the image and the similitude of the Creator. Therefore, the similar features of divinity are in the creation just as they are in the Creator. And as you contemplate the question, who am I? You will find that place within you, that humble space. That place of pure energy. That place of nothingness, yet at the same time, everythingness. And as you contemplate the energy that flows through you, that is truly who you are, you should also understand that this energy is endless, timeless. It's all the power that ever was. It's all the power that ever is, and all the power that ever shall be. And our objective as co-creators is to simply be a channel of this energy, to learn to work with it, allowing it to work through us. And as we learn to work co-creatively with this energy, we'll learn the moments when to step aside and allow it to work of its own accord, and the moments when we step in and we assist the process. We understand the very intricate dance of life that goes on between the creative spirit and the way in which we use the creative spirit in life. So imagine all of the energy centers of your body are activated, the chakras of the body, the bottom of the spine, imagine the color red. Raise the energy up to the chakra above it at the belly button area, imagine the color orange. From there, raise the energy up to the next chakra, just below the rib cage, imagine the color yellow. From there, up to the heart space, imagine the color green. From there, up to the throat, imagine the color blue. From the blue throat chakra up to the third eye, imagine the color violet. And finally, to the top of your head, indigo. These chakras interact at the bottom with the physical, at the second, the orange one, with the emotional, at the third, with the intellectual, at the fourth chakra, with the heart, love center, at the throat, the communication center, at the third eye, the center that allows you to see through dimensions of space and time, and the crown chakra, which allows the energy drawn in from the cosmos, connects you to the above. And through this entire process, your body receives and gives energy all day, every day, throughout your entire life. These are the seven seals of the Book of Revelation. These are the seven seals that allow us to understand truly who we are. So we truly understand the question, who am I? And as you contemplate that question and allow that to reside within your beingness, just bring your energy and attention back to the present moment. Do so on the count of three. Three, coming back to the present moment filled with confidence. Two, coming back to the present moment filled with faith. And one, coming back to the present moment happy, healthy, and whole. Happy, healthy, and whole. And there you have it, my friends. That is our meditation for today. So that's the show. I hope you got a lot of this information. You can check it all out at our website, firstcontactradio.com. Right-hand side of the page, the UFO news is already up there. The daily news, the links will be up there in just a short while. So you can check that out. The song for Wake Up, you can download that for free, pass the word. And we've got a lot of other good news and information there. All the stories that we do each and every day can be found right there. So tomorrow on the show, we have a guest, Peter Robbins. We're going to talk about UFOs. That'll be in the second half of the hour. Until then, you have a great day. Go out there, be safe. Spread your love and light into the world, my friends. For love and light will make a big difference for all of us. Because remember, we're all in this together. Have a great day. I'll be back tomorrow with more news and information. Peace. I'm out of here.